It's funny, when I was here, I did the same exact thing. I sat right at the corner in the back, and there was a time to slip out. I might have looked at that opportunity. But yeah, I graduated in 89. My wife graduated in 89. My daughter just graduated a couple of years ago. And in talking to the Criminal Justice Department, we thought of, you know, some topics that might be relevant to you guys. Talking a little bit, and I don't want to talk a lot about me, but talk a little bit about why I decided to even become an ATF agent. Talk a little bit about what ATF does, and then dive into a little bit of what I experienced, significant things I've experienced, and specifically Baltimore City when I was there. And I have a few videos to show on things that occurred there during the riots a few years ago, and what we did during that time to help out the community. So if there's any questions that you guys have that come up, please don't hesitate to raise your hand or interrupt me. I definitely don't want to be the only one talking, so if there's any questions you have, please let me know. I do want to apologize before I start out. I was trying to get here the other day, and we were involved. I was in LA at the time. We were involved in the shooter at the YouTube headquarters, which took up most of the day on the day I was supposed to fly here. We executed some search warrants at her house and just tried to make sure there was nobody else involved and nobody else out there who's a threat to the community. So I got caught up with that, flew in last night, but very glad to be here. I also want to apologize. I'm not a professional speaker at all. I'm still a government employee. I've never done this before, so bear with me if I trip up or mumble my words or mess up the PowerPoint. So I actually have not done this before. That's not a lie. So just my background, I grew up in New York, moved to Northern Virginia area, went to high school there, and luckily I played soccer and was recruited here to come here to play. First day I came here on my recruiting trip, it was immediately, I knew that this was a good fit. Just the university itself and the soccer team seemed like the type of people that I wanted to play with and be with, and they also had very good teams back then, which they still and continue to have. But I think we were ranked top five most of the time, top 10, final four 1 year, which we should have won, but got robbed on a bad call by the ref. I'll have many excuses like that on things that I talk about, especially soccer games. But came here, and I have to admit, I was not the best student. The school does a good job of giving us opportunities to study, especially the athletic department. I didn't take as much advantage as I should have on that, and I look back and realize that I dropped the ball a little bit there. But I was able to graduate, got through, got my diploma, and when I graduated, at that time there was no soccer leagues in the country. There was I only kicked off for the football team. There wasn't like a lot of opportunities for me in that area, so I really had no clue what I was going to do at all, like many people probably. I was also, you know, just kind of randomly not knowing. I worked at a car wash place in D.C. My wife, who graduated with me, came up to D.C. and we got married pretty young, I think 23 years old. So when I was married, I was like, I got to figure out what I'm doing here. I got to get on the ball. At least I can't be washing cars when I'm married. So I had to figure out what I was going to do. I had an uncle who was making a lot of money on Wall Street, said I could work with him, went up there, wasn't a good fit for me, realized that I wasn't going to be able to stay up there very long with my wife. So I also had a family friend who worked for ATF. I had no idea what ATF was, which some of you might not know either. Said I could get a job being a clerk typist. I didn't know what that was, but basically clerk typist meant I was going to be a copy boy. I was going to stand at the copy machine all day, make copies. Back then, obviously have email, so everybody has to have paper. So I stood at the copy machine a lot, and that was my experience. Luckily, ATF was hiring agents that year, and I was able to jump on that opportunity. So I applied, interviewed, got the agent position. Zero experience with law enforcement, except for sometimes I got in trouble in my life. That's the only experience I had. I was not a criminal justice major, which is another thing that I wish I did. I was a marketing major. The only reason I was a marketing major is because my friends did it, and it seemed like it was just better to go to class with them. But I really wish I was sitting here in criminal justice seats like you guys. So my experience, again, was just minor run-ins with the police and not criminal justice, not never touched a gun in my life, ever. So I basically went in there cold. One thing that ATF does really well, we have our academies down in Glencoe, Georgia, and it's like a 5 or 6 month training program, police academy basically, and there they teach you tactics, criminal law, arrest procedures, interview techniques, policies and procedures, everything that, things that you guys probably learned. But that was the first time I'm learning it, is at the academy. Ironically, my grades were much better there than as a marketing major, but I was able to get through there and come out and ready to hit the street. A lot of my friends joked around because I was the last person they would think would ever be in law enforcement and be an ATF agent. So, it was a little comical there in the beginning, but that changed pretty quickly when I went to DC because I was put in a group in DC in the 90s. If anybody knows, some people may know, and DC in the 90s was the murder capital of the world, and that wasn't just somebody saying, it really was pretty bad there in the 90s. I think they had like 500 murders a year back then. During the 90s, there were several police officers who were shot and killed in the line of duty, and it was totally out of control. It's a lot different now, a lot nicer there. But being thrown into a group in DC, I was right in the mix of everything, and I really didn't have time to joke around. It was pretty serious every day there. But I gained a lot of experience. I was involved in undercover. I did some undercover buys. So at 20, I got hired at 24 years old. A couple years after graduating there, I'm in a back alley in DC buying heroin and crack from guys who I knew who were really killers. They didn't know that I knew that, and they didn't know that I was an ATF agent. But so it got pretty serious, and for the next 9 or 10 years, I was in DC, entrenched in all that, and that's all I was doing. I lost touch a little bit with friends because every day it was just a grind there. So after that, I was able to promote in PG County, which is right outside of DC, if anybody knows the area. And then I became the special agent in charge of the Baltimore Field Division, which handles Maryland and Delaware. After that, for a few years, and we're going to go into some of the riot stuff and things that occurred there, but after that, I became the assistant director in charge of the West region from like Seattle down to Texas and some other spots. I think there's a map on there that I'll show. And then recently, just in January, our agent in charge of LA Field Division, which covers like Central California down to Mexico, he retired, and I asked if I could go out there to get back out of our headquarters into the field. So that's just my background on that. I thought, you know, it might relate to some of that, maybe the grade portion, maybe not knowing what you're going to be doing and not having any experience, but realizing that there are opportunities that you may not know are coming along that pop up that are there. So there's a couple of, again, this is the part that I will probably mess up, but there's a couple slides and videos. These are basically just pictures here. Shows ATF what we focus on, and I'm going to go into some detail on some of that stuff. Our mission really is just violent crime, firearms, explosive storage, bombings, and arson. And that's all going to come into play too. This is how our field divisions are set up. We have 25 field divisions across the country. And this region here, the West, is what I was recently covering. And it's split into three regions. Finds investigations. I have a short video here of a gun buy that we made in PG County when I was a supervisor there. One of the guy with the tank top is an informant of ours. The guy in the white shirt is selling us stolen guns that he stole from a gun store. Ironically, later, if you have time, if you want to look up, Jason Scott is the guy's name. We bought some guns from this guy in his parking lot and realized that Jason Scott was involved in breaking into over 40 homes in PG County, killed several women during the robberies, tied families up, and he was a complete menace. But there's a lot of information on him on the internet. Jason Scott, his name is. He went to trial, actually, and was sentenced to, I think, 99 years. And he's 30 years old, so he won't get out. But this was just one of the buys. Just wanted to show some of the things that we get involved in. That's our main focus there, to be honest, is the violent crime and the firearms piece. Our special response team, this is our SWAT guys. We have teams across the country. If we have high-risk entries, these guys will be called in to assist with that. Normal, everyday stuff our agents will do, but when there's something that's a little bit more high-risk, these guys will get involved. This is just a one-minute video on the special response team. I don't know what that smoke is for. It looks good.
ATF's mission is violent crime. So we go after some of the worst people
on the line.
We want to ensure that the public is going to be safe as a result of our operations. SRT is ATF's tactical team. Our mission is the safe execution of all high-risk enforcement operations for the Bureau and the safe arrest of all of the suspects associated with a high-risk enforcement operation. Some of the folks that we go after are extremely violent. All of our suspects were or are armed at the time of our arrest. But because we are a fully functioning tactical unit, our team stays intact. We will never ever incorporate a member from an outside agency into our stack. Our agents in the field, although very well trained, do not have all the tools that the SRT has at its disposal. So having those tools and the training on how to utilize those tools allows us to more safely execute our mission at hand.
Special response team. Arson explosives is a big piece that we have. We're the federal agency that handles arson investigations, which again will come into play a lot in Baltimore. This is our fire research lab in Annandale, Maryland, in PG, border of PG and Montgomery County. They can do tests there. So if there's a fire or an arson, we can recreate the house. The reason they're showing this Christmas tree is, I don't know if anybody probably doesn't remember, but a few years ago in Annapolis, a family, a few grandchildren were at the grandparents' house in Annapolis, mansion there. And unfortunately, they had a spark on a massive tree just like this that went on fire at the wrong time. It was like 2 in the morning when the grandparents and kids were sleeping. And that house went up in flames very, very quickly, and they all died. The reason we burn this is to kind of show people the danger sometimes of these Christmas trees and how quickly they ignite. So this research laboratory in Annandale, they can, if there's a house, they can recreate things, burn it, and then look at the patterns to see how the arson might have been committed and find the origin sometimes and the cause of arson. So I think it's the only one in the country that exists. Our national response team, this is not the special response team, this is a bunch of certified fire investigators and station specialists. So these are more of seasoned agents across the country. When something massive happens like this, and this is actually the house, the picture of the mansion that the family was in. And at the time I was in Baltimore, and I asked the national response team to come in and help because it was just so massive, and they bring in the expertise, and they do a phenomenal job of that. This is just a quick video of what they do. And again, this is a team that comes into Baltimore later during the riots.
Special agents, lab personnel, fire research personnel from across the country. So when a fire occurs within a municipality where they believe our level of expertise at the national response team would benefit them in their investigation, they request that resource through a certified fire investigator and then through the special agent in charge of the field division.
We bring a lot of resources to the table very, very quickly. And it's resources that are both hard to get in and expensive for local municipalities.
It doesn't cost the state and locals anything. That's part of the ATF mission, is to support our state and local counterparts. And the level of knowledge and expertise that we bring is our purpose, is to support them and assist them with whatever they need in order to get to the truth of what happened in an incident.
It's ATF bringing our resources into the scene and bringing our expertise into the scene, and then working it side by side with our local partners.
It's a one-team concept. There's not ATF and state locals. It's one team looking for the facts and the truth for that incident, and our relationship gets stronger every time that we deploy our teams.
So these guys will come in, they'll sift through all the evidence and then try to determine how an explosive was made or how fire occurred and where it occurred. And you can see the difference between those guys and the SRT guys. The SRT guys are in shape and young. These guys are a little bit more seasoned. And it's the funny thing about them is I asked them to come into Baltimore immediately, and I'll show that in a minute. But these are a bunch of older guys and women coming in from across the country. And I'm asking them to come into Ground Zero in Baltimore. And it was a challenge. I mean, they were actually pretty scared to come in because there was a lot going on. And we had to really manage that a lot because we asked them to process, if any of you remember, and I'll show some of it, the CBS, some of these places that burned down were right in the middle of all of the chaos. And now I'm asking all these, you know, guys who were basically ready to retire to come into Baltimore into the middle of Ground Zero. So. But they did a phenomenal job. Our labs are very important. They're forensic. There's a lot of opportunities there for employment. Very interesting, and it's changing with technology. There's a lot we're doing now with shell casings, matching shell casings from different shootings. It's called NIBIN, National Integrated Ballistic Information Network. So they can take shell casings from a city like Baltimore, throw them in this system all day long, and they can match shootings and get leads that really weren't there before. It's huge for us. It really is a game changer for a lot of police departments across the country because we're putting all these shell casings in. And just a quick example, we had a girl, a little three-year-old girl who was killed in Baltimore on a drive. She was just in the wrong place. There was a drive-by and she got hit. It was obviously a very horrible situation for everybody in the city, but there were no leads on there, nobody was talking. We did have the shell casings, though, that were on the ground, put them in the system, and then eventually there was another shooting, shell casings put in. We had leads on that shooting, and now we're able to use those leads, knowing that the shell casings matched, knowing that those people were probably involved in the death of that little girl. So this is massive for us. We're using it. We're just doing it to try to make sure we're helping police departments with violent crime. We also regulate the FFL industries. That's what these guys do. They'll do inventory at the gun stores to make sure everybody's books are good, trying to make sure we have good relationships with the gun owners, gun stores. So quickly now to get into Baltimore more detail. So I was the SAC there, I was a special agent in charge there when the Baltimore riots occurred. Freddie Gray, I think it was April 12th, he was arrested. He was put in a hospital immediately, and I think it was April 19th where he ended up passing away. There was funeral and other things that started happening that started getting more and more momentum, and things started getting heated up a little bit more in the city. Ironically, though, on April 27th, it was a beautiful day, and I remember just going to lunch. It really wasn't any indication something serious was going to happen. But that afternoon, things changed pretty quickly, and this is kind of what started happening that afternoon. As you can tell, people were pretty angry that day. They were very angry with the police. And the problem at the time, and the police commissioner would admit this if he was here, the officers were not really equipped for this, and they were not really they didn't really plan for any of this. Their equipment was old. They were told that day, make a line, but let them protest and don't interfere. We had a lot of task force officers from Baltimore City that were assigned to our groups that were told to immediately get out there and stand on the line. And I remember talking to our guys, they had no idea what they were supposed to do or any direction. They were just told to stand out there and stand in the line. Without any shields, and people were throwing rocks in their faces. We had a task force officer who I saw come back probably 2 a.m. after all this with 35 stitches on his face because he got hit by a rock in the face. So it was very intense, very out of control, and the police department really wasn't equipped at the time to deal with it. As you can see, this officer here is literally throwing a rock back at protesters. So I know that's not really something that officers are supposed to do and not taught. So you could see both sides, it was just mayhem. So that night, I actually went over to the police department, talked to the commissioner, and tried to find out what we could bring to the table, and we'll get into some of that. This is just some other video. People on the street who videotaped some of it.
Are these the officers? These guys, those shields were really old. They had to dust them off.
So a lot of police departments come across Maryland to get and try to help, but
there was really not a set response plan in place for everybody, and we're all just trying to figure out what to do. It's really tough to get a grip.
Started pumping things up even more with their cameras. People wanted to talk, people wanted to show how mad they were, which is understandable. It just started getting to where you really couldn't control it. Now, I do have to say, Baltimore City Police, some of the best officers I've ever worked with, there was no real thought that this would ever happen, so nobody really planned for it. This picture, the one thing on this picture that's important, this bottom one here, you can see that fire hose is broken. That guy right there, as the CVS was looted and somebody put it on fire, this guy, when the fire department was trying to put it out, stabbed the fire hose with a knife, so fire department couldn't really do anything there. Now, right next to the CVS is a retirement home, and that came very close to going on fire, where there was a lot of elderly people in there that never would have made it out. That fire department is like 5 feet, that CVS is like 5 feet from the retirement home, and that would have been catastrophic if that happened. And it really did come very close. That building was melted a little bit, where the elderly people were saying, and that would have been a total nightmare. Now, a lot of people, though, in Baltimore, if you've ever been there, they rely on this store. This is where everybody gets all their stuff. It's not like there's a bunch of big food stores in the middle of the city there. So this is especially those people in the old folks' home, this is where they went to get their meds, their food, everything they needed. So what happened is some people saw an opportunity to break into the CVS, steal medication, opioids, and just completely took over the place. And then this guy decided to stay at the fire hose. This guy here on this video, he owned a liquor store. He's an Asian male sitting there on the side. And this guy in the shirt is also pissed off like everybody else is. And he decides to just kick him in the head for no reason. End up finding him later. And then they ended up burning down his store, which basically was his whole life savings put into it. So then we just started seeing all these different incidents with the fire became like a big thing everybody decided to do. This guy just made his own devices from stuff he stole from the CVS, standing in the middle of the street. You see the police back there, they're really not sure what to do, so they're just told by their commissioner, don't intervene, let them protest, which started making things a little bit worse. As you can see, the fire's all across the city. That's a police car right there that's on fire. And it was, as you can see, mayhem. So they asked us to bring in that national response team that I showed you before. They specialize in arsons, and we need to find out who burned these places down, because the community actually was not happy about places being burned down. They were mad at the situation, and they wanted to protest, but they didn't think that burning down these stores that people put all their money into and really relied on was the right thing to do. So we were able to bring those guys in that I showed you before and had them go to some of these scenes to process them. We had 7 scenes immediately that we needed to process right away. This actually is not my PowerPoint, so I apologize for that. So we had to be physically at 7 arson scenes at the same time. We had some guys from down here in South Carolina who came up, 55-year-old ATF agent, and I'm asking them to come into Baltimore City where all this was still happening. So I had to make sure that these scenes were secure and people weren't gonna mess with these guys, which we did, but we also made sure we were going to these scenes at like very early in the morning, and that we were trying to do as much as we could, as quickly as we could, so these guys are not sitting there all day and they're not wandering around, because tensions were still very high in the city. We started putting out rewards to the community because, again, like I said, people were not happy with this in the community. So we put $10,000 rewards for all these guys that you saw in the videos before, the guy in the street. This ended up being the guy who actually brought down to CVS and put out those rewards. And we were going to pay the $10,000 if somebody told us who they were. That was really our only way of finding out. This is just some clips about that.
Now, meanwhile, just more than 3 weeks since the Baltimore riots, and now there are some clear leads about those who did some of the most damage to the city.
Yeah, today, the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and Explosives released wanted posters in an attempt to locate and arrest arson suspects. ABC 2 News' Brian Kubler is here now with more. Brian.
Jamie, the ATF is investigating 7 arsons during the riots and one instance of setting off crude explosive devices against police at Penn North. But today, the Bureau was able to release screenshots of suspects in some of the cases, and the reward is as clear as some of the pictures.
The ATF used almost 100 agents to look through hundreds of hours of video from surveillance cameras, closed-circuit TV, and broadcast media to find the people they say are responsible for burning Baltimore. First are these pictures from the arson at Cash Pawn USA on West Pratt Street. The images are stills from that store's surveillance video. It seems to be closed-circuit TV cameras in part providing the image of this man. ATF feels he is responsible for setting that Penn North CVS on fire. The Rite Aid on Martin Luther King Boulevard was looted and burned too. Agents released these photos of the man they feel did that damage. Same here at the Fireside North Liquor Store on West North Avenue. A combination of surveillance and City Watch cameras caught that man in the act. But perhaps the clearest of them all is the suspect agents say built and set off at least 4 crude explosive or incendiary devices in the intersection of Pennsylvania and North Avenues. There were several pictures of him pouring lighting fluid on small propane devices. In all, the ATF released 5 reward posters this afternoon. The agency is hoping the public can help identify who is in these pictures.
That guy was...
If you recognize anyone on those posters, you're urged to call the ATF tip line at 1-888-ATF-FIRE. Your tip can be confidential. The reward in each of these cases is $10,000. The ATF says they do have solid leads on the other 3 arsons as well and will continue combing over video for images in those cases too.
We did set up a video, like an upload thing where people could upload videos that they had on the street because there was so many people that had their cameras and their phones out. The video information, the evidence that we got from just street cameras, the media, we had to subpoena information from the media. We're not allowed to get that without going through a process. Their pictures were much clearer. So we were getting pictures from media, pictures from the street cameras that the city had up, and then just citizens with their cell phones. And we wanted it all uploaded, and you could anonymously upload it to this website. And we were combing through all of it to try to figure out and put pieces together on who was responsible for that stuff. We put out these wanted posters. We had different versions for the police officers and then for the public, because there was some information on there and police flyers we couldn't put to the public. This is just when we subpoena information from the media. So this is why this information was huge for us. Metadata, which I'm not a computer whiz, but I know that was critical to find out that the guy who burned down the CVS was at that place, and then we were able to use that to put other pieces together. But these high-resolution photos that the media we were able to get from were huge for that. There's another one from the media that we used to put his face on the posters. This guy was also teaching other people while he was out there how to make these explosives. And you'll see maybe some of that. Yeah, I think this is a guy that he was teaching how to make the same things he was making. You see the same type of... devices that he had, this guy has, and he was trying to get everybody to burn stuff down that day. There's the picture that shows like the same type of Coleman that they were putting on fire. This is, if this isn't good, I'll click off.
This is really just
making sure that we keep reminding everybody in the community about
attempting, and in some cases, setting fires to some of those buildings. The ATF sent out flyer after flyer of those photos. Now they've compiled some of them into an interactive map. Each marker on the map corresponds with a surveillance shot and the name of the store that was set on fire. You can even make the images larger and click on a link under the photo for more information. There's a reward of up to $10,000 for information leading to an arrest and conviction.
So the technology stuff really came into play, and that's changed a lot. I've been with ATF for 26 years, and so having this technology really made a difference as far as making sure that the community was, this was continuing to be discussed, and that we had people
and I'm John
who were going to try to help us find
it. They tracked down a man responsible for some of the worst damage during Baltimore's riots.
They believe he is responsible for setting fire to a CVS pharmacy in West Baltimore during the riots. Karen Parks, live at police headquarters, where investigators announced the arrest of a suspect accused of setting fire at the CVS at Pennsylvania North. Karen.
Kai and Jennifer, police say 24-year-old Raymond Carter intentionally set fire to that CVS in West Baltimore. He's now charged with federal arson violations.
Raymond Carter, he is a criminal who took advantage of our city when we were most vulnerable.
Today, police announced the arrest of Raymond Carter, accused of setting the fire in the CVS pharmacy on Pennsylvania North Avenue during Baltimore's riots. The unrest occurred after the funeral of Freddie Gray, the West Baltimore man who died after being taken into police custody.
The very same CVS that people who live in that neighborhood relied on for their medication, for their food, for toiletries in that community.
Carter was arrested today in Federal Hill.
As the agents who were marked in ATF police attire approached Mr. Carter as he fled from the agents, refusing multiple commands to stop. A brief foot chase ensued, and BPD officers helped canvass the area as the agents were able to eventually apprehend Mr. Carter.
A task force that has been viewing video of those involved in incidents that took place during the riots says its investigation doesn't stop here.
We've arrested 11 adults, 7 juveniles, and we have 8 outstanding arrest warrants. These charges, they're all state charges, run the gamut from reckless endangerment, assault, robbery, malicious destruction of property, burglary, and theft.
Although this investigation is ongoing, police believe that Carter acted alone in this incident and that his actions caused more than $1 million worth of damage. Reporting live here at City Police Headquarters, Karen Parks, Fox 25 News.
This is really just a media person who put this together, so they discussed some of the issues we do in press conferences and everything. Sorry about these pictures and stuff. This is, so we, for the fires and everything, that was important. We needed to make sure people knew that that was not acceptable. The community did not want places being burnt down that they owned and that they used. But there's still a problem with the violence in the city. Officers were kind of withdrawing their job. They there was 5-6 officers arrested for Freddie Gray's incident. So a lot of other officers in Baltimore City were looking at that like, hey, if I'm out there working, I may get arrested. So there was a little problem there where there wasn't as much officers out on the street as normal. And there was still a lot of people pissed off at the situation. So there was a lot of violence occurring. And to be honest, one thing, I went to a meeting where somebody explained it this way, that if I'm walking down the street and Brandon is there, and we get in an argument, in the past, maybe we would fight and punch each other in the face. Now, people were walking down the street with guns in their waistband because there wasn't as much police enforcement out there. And now if Brandon and I got in an argument, I'm pulling my gun out and shooting him in the middle of the street. So the violence started really increasing. The amount of murders, I think, were breaking records in Baltimore, and it was still very volatile. So we brought in agents from, again, from different parts of the East Coast to assist with that piece now, because we were moving away from the arson stuff and now needed to focus on the violence and the shooting. So,
This is just.
But about murders in Baltimore.
Yeah, no, I am sorry. This is actually, I did not put this together to pat myself on the back. This is from our media guy who talked to about challenges with the media.
And interim police commissioner calling in federal agents to help detectives counter the massive spike in violence. On record, Script Jenkins spoke with an ATF agent in Baltimore.
ATF has a long history of working, targeting
again,
crime,
you see how
criminal organizations, repeat offenders, and neighborhood crews that are more long-term investigations. They're proactive cases that take time. Right now, we were able to bring in agents from different areas along the East Coast for boots on the ground. That was the immediate need that the city needs right now to try to do what we can. So it's kind of a two-pronged approach. We're still continuing our proactive cases, but now we have agents who are experienced agents working on the street, boots on the ground, working undercover operations, working with informants, and they're going to be here for at least 60 days.
So is Baltimore and all their leadership, are they over their heads? The On the Record legal panel joins us, former homicide detective and criminal defense attorney Ted Williams and former prosecutor Katie Fay. Ted, I do not blame the police in Baltimore. I blame the political leadership there.
Well, absolutely I blame the political leadership in Baltimore. They have done nothing but sit on their butts until now.
Getting millions of dollars in money to fix these problems.
And you've got to wonder, putting band-aids on the problem is not help. But I got to tell you, there's a new sheriff in town. When you're bringing in the federal agents here to actually assist, some of these bad guys now will go off the street. And you've got people like Bill McMullen of the ATF, who has a wealth of experience that he brings to this dogfight. Bad guys, look out. The feds are here.
You know, Katie, I'm all...
I paid him some money, so... that actually didn't really happen. I mean... We did as much as we could, but the impact really wasn't seen that much, to be honest. Because there's more to it. And I don't know if you guys discussed this or not, but it's not just a law enforcement piece, locking people up and throwing them in jail. There's a lot more to it as far as the community and the relationships between law enforcement and the community, giving people opportunities to get jobs and things like that. There's a lot of different factors. We would meet monthly with people in the community and leaders in the community and other law enforcement officials and sit and talk to people who just got out of jail and talk to them about trying to get on the right path, giving them opportunities to find jobs and stuff. So, you know, we were trying to do as much as we could as far as the law enforcement side, but that isn't the only thing that's going to change things like this in some of the cities. So there's definitely a lot more to it than, like I said, just going out and putting people in handcuffs. So some of these other videos, I'm gonna try to skip through some of these.
Last month was the most murderous.
They started a thing called a war room where all the agencies got together. Probably not a good word to use in that situation because, like I said, it's a community. We don't want the community thinking we're at war with them. But that's unfortunately what it was called at the time, and it's a matter of trying to get all the agencies together to work together.
Most violent repeat offenders.
But
well, tonight, and
the aim wasn't really
as our camera was the only one
best thing
in this war room, and our Brian Kubler was the only reporter.
Jimmy, the war room was introduced with much fanfare in a big press conference last month. Commissioner Kevin Davis was flanked by the mayor, state's attorney, and others. He spoke of the same kind of things we've heard before and how they're going to go after the really bad guys. But they say it hasn't been done like this before.
The violent crime this summer is dizzying. The sheer amount of shell casings on city streets and now the scary round number of 200 bodies reached much earlier than in recent years. There's a battle on our streets and now a war for them.
The war room. That collaboration.
Their commissioner got fired.
Another,
the other one that was gone last.
And figuring out the case. That's the rule in Baltimore.
Interim Police Commissioner Kevin Davis is hoping the crime doesn't define the fight, but that the fight defines the crime. He stood up what he called the war room a month ago, an effort to not just say different agencies are working together, but forcing them to belly up at the same table to figure it out.
My analogy to the war room is, If I had a puzzle to put together and I had 1,500 puzzle pieces and I needed to put the puzzle together right now, I can't do that on the telephone. I can't do that with a text message. I can't do that with an email. I can't do that with a conference call.
We've taken what took weeks, if not months before, and have built something that takes days.
If the post-Freddie Gray crime surge is a puzzle, then it's Colonel Sean Miller who's already laid out the border, working inward to piece it together. Miller is the commander of the war room and runs the briefings between city police, federal agents, and prosecutors. ABC 2 News is the first news organization allowed to witness a war room briefing. We agreed to disconnect our microphones, blur faces of undercover agents, and shoot around sensitive case material as the group literally compared notes on violent crimes, threads, trends, and most importantly, building prosecutable cases against a list of those worst of the worst criminals. From there, the colonel says, it's just simple math.
The small group of bad guys in the city are the ones doing all the violent crime. And once they are identified and their associates are identified, the subtraction process, you will see that lower level of homicides and non-fatal shootings coming.
It's just that simple.
Just that simple.
And while the formula is drawn up on the seventh floor, it's carried out on the street. Federal agents are working with city police on the ground to execute the warrants, seize the guns, and arrest the targets they believe are responsible for the crime. Baltimore PD now has the expertise and resources of the FBI, DEA, Marshals, Secret Service, and the ATF by their side and immediately available to arrest and build cases. Like here last week in Northeast Baltimore as a war room team served a warrant on a drug case with an assist from a rather cute federal resource, an explosive-sniffing ATF dog named Cacao. But it's not just the pooch. ATF, for its part, dedicated 10 of its agents from Charlotte to Boston to work with Baltimore City Police.
We didn't bring these agents in from other field divisions to sit in our office and sit behind a computer all day. So they will physically be out there every day during this detail working with Baltimore City to actively target those individuals.
It's no longer just cooperation with federal partners in theory or spirit. The feds now have skin in the game, so to speak. A vested interest in pulling out some of Baltimore's violence at the root. But crime fighting is a results-oriented business. While police say it is too early to talk stats, the war room is boasting some homicide closures, increase in seized guns, and the rapid arrest for a triple shooting of three teens late last month.
We have four violent crime strands going on in Baltimore right now, and what the war room's been able to do is put pieces together, connect bad guys from one strand to another, and we've made up some positive results.
But time will tell if the war room.
So I don't want to keep showing videos that are kind of talking about the same thing. But so this new commissioner was very good. He in my opinion, was like born to be a cop. This guy, but he started looking more at the community piece too. He started making officers, and this is just something that's probably not known, but it's kind of interesting, I think. He started making officers educate themselves on Baltimore City history and made them get out of their cars. So there was officers that weren't getting out of their cars and talking to people on the street. They were just in their car, working their beat, doing their shift and going home. He made them document that they talked to people on the street throughout their shifts, made them educate themselves on the history of Baltimore so that they could have a conversation with somebody and get out more of their car and walk around a little bit like police a long time ago used to do. So again, there was a lot of things that they tried to do to make the situation between the police and the community better. I don't know if anybody has any questions on any of that stuff. I can show a little bit more. Yes.
Okay, so one reason I came today was to ask a question about during riots when the police are observing multiple instances of the law being violated, how do they really decide which individuals in a crowd to prosecute? Because there are just so many things going on that I don't know if you have any experience with officers having to deal with that type of situation. But
yeah,
that seems like a difficult task.
I think every situation is different, right? So this thing here was a lot of people doing a lot of things they're not allowed to do. There's some that are on a smaller scale where it's a little bit more manageable. But with this situation, and it also takes time. Some cases it was pretty immediate. Like you could, if you're doing something right in front of me and I can arrest you right there and it's something that should be done, and I'm gonna arrest you right there. There's other things that people might be doing that they don't have evidence yet, but it takes time to, there was hundreds of hours of video that officers and everybody had to look at. So it took time to identify some other people that did things, even small, like throwing rocks at police cars. I mean, that's not something that would be a priority to jump on right away, but eventually after going through all the evidence, you start identifying, you know, the people that burned down the CVSs, people that are assaulting officers, assaulting people in the street. And then after that, there's maybe some people that did some things that are a little bit minor, but that may take months down the road to go after. But they weren't gonna, they wanted to make sure, definitely in Baltimore, that the message got out that, hey, you can protest here and everybody understands that you have the right to go out and protest. But just don't burn down stores and kick people in the head and throw rocks at people's faces. So that was something that needed to be done, and they're still looking at video because there's so much. But I don't know if that answers it. I think there,
that answers the question, really. Just they need the time and they need the evidence build up to deal with that thing.
Yeah, sometimes that's the case.
Thank you.
Thanks for saying I answered it correctly, too. yes?
For any of the $10,000 rewards filled, or did you guys find the guys first?
I personally handed $10,000 to the person. No. All of this, these people arrested for these fires, we weren't able to really identify them without people telling us who they were. That's why we blasted their faces all over the place. But when we got called about someone who said, I think this is the guy who burned down the CVS, and we put those pieces together, and that was the person, I personally handed $10,000 to that person. So, and that was important, and so I'm glad you asked that, because we didn't want that to be a thing where, oh, we're giving $10,000 if you tell us who did it, up to $10,000, and we'll give you like $100 after. Because that would be a problem for us in the future with the community thinking they're full of crap. They say they're going to give it a reward, and they're not giving it to us. So we I specifically told the people in Baltimore in my office that if we get information from somebody that results in the arrest of these guys, it's going to be important message out to everybody that we are giving them the money that we said we're going to give them. So I think we gave, I don't know, there might be a thing on here, four or five people that money for the information they gave us. That was huge for us. Any other questions on that? Yes, sir.
Why do you think police brutality happens?
I think there's definitely a training piece that is now changing. And I think that's really the whole key to it, is really training police officers correctly. So there's so many police departments across the country. Some of them train really well on this, some of them might not have. And I can tell you that some of the conferences I've been to, police chief conferences where every chief in the country is there, and over the last couple of years, there's a big emphasis in those conferences on making sure that officers are treating people with respect, no matter who they are or where they come from. Making sure that, like the examples in Baltimore, that officers are getting out of the car and making sure they're engaging with the people in the community and being part of the community instead of a battle between the community and officers. It's huge. It's huge for officers to treat people with respect. And when things like this happen and other incidents across the country, as I've been saying throughout this, people get really irritated at that when an officer who might not have been trained right decides to shoot somebody who's not armed. And that causes a lot of issues, as we all know. But I can't answer the question for every officer in the country, but I can say that it's a big push for departments across the country to make sure that they're training officers to
to make sure they're not stepping over the line and making sure they're treating people with respect. So, it's definitely been a major issue, but I can tell you that going to some of these conferences, that is the main topic of discussion. There's different administrations across the country that hold conferences for officers specifically to talk about that topic. And, I think that's obviously very important. I don't know if I answered it for you, but I hear you. It's not good when that happens. And it's very important to continue making sure that the training is continuing and the community relations are continuing. Any other questions on that? We started putting billboards up just to now start going into more of the firearm phase in Baltimore City and the violence there. That was just a joke. I'm hesitant to click on this, but I think this just might be another click.
We have heard terms like war room and BFED, and we're told agencies like the Secret Service and FBI.
I think this is more of that technology piece that I was telling you about, the Niven piece, the shell cases.
The feds are more than
just really
focusing
on that.
Lending brains to the fight. As well.
So this is probably worth watching.
ABC2 was the first to show you inside the Baltimore Police War Room, where city police, federal agents, and prosecutors belly up to one table to share intel, target arrests, build cases against the worst of the worst. The plan is devised here and carried out here. One of the federal agencies signed up for the detail is ATF. Their agents working side by side with city police these past few weeks to stem the violent tide.
There's been arrests already made.
I was hoping that
runs getting off the street. And for us, that's the main goal, is getting guns off the street. Finding out where the guns are coming from and getting these trigger pullers off the street.
We're only as strong as our relationships with our federal law enforcement partners.
And as the interim police commissioner detailed in a rather large news conference earlier this month, those federal resources can help clear up a confusing violent crime picture rather quickly.
So that gun we recover on the east side is connected to the shell casings recovered on the west side.
Can
and now we have non-federal partners, particularly from ATF, who can help us put the pieces to that puzzle together.
Did several
this
times.
Is the one you just put in.
This is the one I just put in.
This is the shell casing thing. Now look at
the puzzle also comes together here at ATF laboratory in Beltsville. Here is where the ATF anchors its National Integrated Ballistic Information Network, or NIBIN, to expand the library of spent shell casings and bullets. Markings on either are like fingerprints for a gun, and more than 150 labs across the U.S., including here in Baltimore, are constantly entering evidence and data into that library.
This matches with the firing pin, it's pretty obvious, but most of the time we get like striations.
You can match them up.
Yeah, we can match things up like this.
Aaron Hine is one of the technicians logging and analyzing evidence looking for a match. It's called a lead or a hit when the unique characteristics on the casings match up, and ATF may be able to link that gun to other casings gathered in other crimes. Iron Hope, or match the casing to a recovered gun that has been processed and test fired here at the laboratory.
It will provide leads of previously unknown shootings to the investigators who can then follow up on those leads.
Walter Dandridge is the firearms examiner at the ATF lab. Data collection from all across the country is what makes this system so valuable, and Baltimore does its part. Since April through June of this year, Baltimore police picked up 622 casings off city streets and logged them into the system, resulting in 43 hits or leads for its detectives. Investigations now aided directly by ATF agents since the city's war room was launched.
We can track firearms trends with the cartridge cases and cross-reference that those hits that we get from those recovered cartridge cases to the crime stats map.
Valuable information in determining where the bullets are fired and from which guns. An important piece to the puzzle can help illustrate the picture of what and who is driving Baltimore's violent summer.
So I was saying
that for comparison, in the same time frame, this April through June, Washington
starting to grow every year. We've had this technology for a long time, and we dropped the ball as an agency. Started picking it up a few years ago and realizing how important it can be. We have a center down in Huntsville, Alabama, that has a bunch of these police departments across the country. Put these shell casings in, they go there, and they'll do those comparisons that the lady was showing. There's 20 people there now. We got funding to hire up to 100 now, and have our goal is to have every police department in the country dump the shell casings in there so we can start matching all over the country, and there aren't any gaps. That's hopefully something that'll happen down the road. One thing I was thinking about when I was watching that was a question that you had, sir, on the police brutality thing. That war room name is a good example of how things need to change in police minds. I mean, just having it, again, having that name, the war room, it doesn't sound good for anybody who lives in that community to say, oh, there's a war room that all these officers are sitting in trying to figure out how they're going to fight the war against people in the community. So that's definitely a lesson learned from this whole thing. We've talked about it. And if that comes up again, hopefully it'll just be called an intel center or something like that, but not a war room. That's definitely not the message today. And as you can see, that was being put out on the news every night. So now people are watching the news in that community saying, look at these guys starting up a war room on us. So I was just thinking that after you asked your question when they were talking more about that, because it's repetitive in this PowerPoint, but it was every night in Baltimore, citizens are watching that. So there's a lot of lessons learned. Those things, this commissioner, both commissioners have gone around and talked about things like that to chiefs across the country. And I think it's just a big part of raising awareness to other officers and getting that training piece and learning lessons from things that maybe weren't done the right way. So anyway, that NIBIN, that's the NIBIN piece I was talking about. Totally putting a lot of our money and resources into it as an agency in ATF, and it's going to continue. These are some results of some of the people that we showed earlier. Also, like your question, it is kind of tough to see some of the sentences, because you would think others would be higher sentences than others who just burn something in the street, but a lot of it has to do with their criminal history and what they've been involved in the past, and then they get different levels. So, for instance, this guy here, 15 years for just doing that, but he had 3 felony convictions of violent crime, and so when that starts adding up, the years start adding up. The guy who kicked the owner in the head and burnt down the store got some years. But we definitely wanted, there was more money than that put out eventually, but and the guy at CBS only got 4 years. He had really no criminal history. That's actually the guy who stabbed a hose, who got probation, but had to go through court and stuff. But this was something that we wanted to put out too, because again, the community didn't want this stuff happening. They wanted to voice their opinion and their frustration of what was going on, and that was important for everybody, but this is not what people wanted. So it was important to put this out also to let people know that it wasn't acceptable and the people who did this were going to be held responsible. I am glad to see there are no more videos. There's other things that our public information guy put in, because this is really a training PowerPoint. It was much easier for me to use his PowerPoint than try to figure out. I couldn't even figure out how to click to the next slide on this. So I used his, and it talks more about some media stuff. But I don't know. If there's anybody has any questions or want to talk about anything else, or if not, hopefully me coming here, at least the one thing we can all say is I think you got some points for something. Maybe for just showing up, so I'm glad that at least I was able to help with that. Because I know when I was here, I could have used some extra points once in a while. But yeah, again, I appreciate everybody letting me be here. But if there's any questions, I'll be happy to try to answer them before we roll out. And that's kind of bad, because now anybody who asks a question is going to be responsible for us standing here longer. But. Oh, yes.
For people that want to work for the ATF, what are the qualifications that they need now?
Another good question. We're looking for people from all different backgrounds. Diversity is very important for us. Make sure we have people from all different places and backgrounds. You'd be surprised, really, on the criteria. You can have a college degree and apply to be an agent. You don't have to have prior experience. I didn't have prior law enforcement experience in a uniform, but just on other incidents. I never touched a gun. Right now, it's pretty simple. We have Schedule B hiring. We got that authority a few years ago, where really all it takes is an email to our recruiter in the local office and your resume. And that's for agent positions. Some of the other positions they'll announce on USA Jobs. We have jobs in the lab. You know, that's something that's huge for us regarding NIBIN. So we have opportunities there. The industry operations investigators that I showed real quickly, those are the people that regulate the firearms and explosives industry and make sure that their inventory is right and make sure they're keeping their records. There's opportunities there also on USA Jobs. But I think at your fair yesterday, our local office was there, hopefully gave out some information for people. But the easiest way to do it is, for an agent position, is send an email saying you're interested in attaching your resume to the recruiter in this Charlotte Field Division. Charlotte Field Division covers North Carolina and South Carolina, so they run the Columbia office. And there's probably people that are here that don't live here, and you can apply in the area you live also. But it's actually not that complicated to apply. And then there's different things you have to go through. Polygraph, which luckily they didn't have that when I got hired, because I didn't commit any violent crimes, but adding up some things, I don't know if I would have been able to get through. So I'm just being honest with that. But so they have polygraph, they do a background, they have a fitness test, and an interview. So after you put the email in with your resume, they'll get back to people and say, okay, we're going to start these different phases. And unfortunately, it does take some time in the government. It's not as quick as everybody would want it to be. But it's not that hard to apply. And as far as qualifications, you don't have to have prior experience. You can just have graduated South Carolina and send an email with your resume. And you're more than welcome to send it to me, too, and I'll send it to our hiring department in our headquarters. I've done that a lot with friends, family friends, my daughter's friends who are interested. Send me an email and I'll get it to the people who process all of it. So I don't know if my email, I know Brandon has it, but it's not that complicated. So if that's simpler, if you just want to send me an email, I'll get it to our HR department. Any other questions? All right. Hey, thank you. I appreciate you.